So thank you everybody for coming. For those of you who don't know, this is our new space, Masaha. It was created to build a community for the growing digital freedoms and open culture movement in Lebanon and the broader region. For the past few months, well, since February at least, we've been holding regular events here, such as this one that we're having tonight. My name is Lara Bitar. I'm the editorial director here at SMEX. And I will be in conversation with Katherine Maher, or Mayor, for about 30 minutes or so, and then we're going to open it up for a Q&A for another 30 minutes. So in preparation for tonight's event, the first thing I did was Google Katherine's name. So when you do that, So I Googled Katherine's name, and this is the first search item that came up, which is her Wikipedia page. And through her page, you can know pretty much everything about her professional life, but also a bit of her personal life. So for those of you who don't know, she's the executive director of the Wikimedia Foundation since June 2016, right? So that led me to the Wikimedia Foundation's page on Wikipedia too, of course. The Wikimedia Foundation is an American nonprofit and charitable organization located in San Francisco, and it's widely known for participating in the Wikimedia movement. Then I got slightly sidetracked and went to the San Francisco page for about 5 minutes or so. And through that, I landed on the 1906 San Francisco earthquake and fire, and read it for a few minutes as well. Checked out some photos, like this one from the fire. And this one comes from the Wikimedia Commons. And this is the Wikimedia Commons, which is a collection of over 38 million freely usable media files that anybody can use and anybody can contribute to. And then I went back to the Wikimedia page to check out some of the projects and initiatives. And for those of you who don't know, these are, you know, in addition to Wikipedia that's most widely known, there's Wikispaces, Wikiversity, the Wikipedia Commons, Wikimedia Commons, Wikidata, and a whole bunch of other initiatives that encourage open knowledge and the free exchange of knowledge. Their latest initiative is the one for Open Citations, which was launched in just April 2017. So the initiative for Open Citations is a collaboration between scholarly publishers, researchers, and other interested parties to promote the unrestricted availability of scholarly citation data. And I learned of the Wikimedia Movement, which is a global community of contributors to Wikimedia projects, and it includes something around 70,000 volunteers. That's incredible. So that led me back to Wikipedia, which is a free online encyclopedia with the aim to allow anybody to edit and write articles. It's the largest and most popular general reference work on the internet and is ranked among the top 10 most popular websites. So I could go on for a while, but I'm going to stop here. So there are 290 Wikipedia encyclopedias, 40 million articles, 250 languages, and the largest is the English Wikipedia that has over 5 million articles. The Arabic Wikipedia, on the other hand, is one of the smaller encyclopedias online. So even though we are over 350 million Arabs around the Middle East and North Africa, we don't contribute as much as others around the globe. It started on July 9, 2003, and we still only have about 500,000 articles, even though there are over 1 million registered users. So in Lebanon, I'm going to briefly talk about our own open knowledge projects. So we've had several experiments with collaborative projects, some initiated by SMEX. For example, we have New Wave, which is an open online directory of Lebanon's members of parliament. We have Open Lab, which is a shared commons of data and tools for Lebanon, and it's made for use by the public. We have Nathawal, which is an online learning for the Arab Information Society. And finally, Tasharuk, which means to collaborate in Arabic. And it's a collaborative knowledge base for net citizens. So we invited Katherine tonight so she can share with us her experience with open knowledge projects and share some of her ideas that could help local Wikipedians and proponents of open knowledge in Lebanon and the region. Do we have any Wikipedians in the audience? Anybody who's had any experience with open knowledge projects and initiatives? Okay. Has anybody ever edited an article on Wikipedia? Of course.
Oh, you're all Wikipedians.
Okay, so you all are. So without further ado, I'm going to turn it to you, and maybe we can start talking about the importance and impact of such projects.
Absolutely. Thank you, first of all, for having me here this evening, and thank you for coming out. I'm delighted to be here back in Beirut, and I'm very happy to be here to talk a little bit about Wikipedia, and specifically Arabic Wikipedia. But before I get started, you know, Lara gave a really excellent introduction to who we are. 16 years ago, we started as an encyclopedia that anybody can edit, and today we are much more than that. We are a free knowledge ecosystem, and what that means is that all of the content within the Wikimedia projects are open and available to anyone in the world to participate, to use, to remix, to share. We encourage people to join us as part of our free knowledge movement, and really so many people have. The 70,000 active contributors every single month is just actually a small portion of the people who've contributed over time. We know that English Wikipedia alone has received participation from more than 6 million people over the 16 years we've been around, and the numbers are actually much larger than that, because that doesn't even count people who've never registered accounts but have just made changes, and it certainly doesn't cover the other 300 or so languages that we exist in. So, incredible participation from around the globe that has built this incredible project, and it's a project that is used by hundreds of millions of people every single month. We receive, on average, visits from about a billion devices from every corner of the globe on a monthly basis, which does make us one of the world's largest websites and also one of the world's most popular. Today, we think of ourselves as a movement for free knowledge, not just a contributing community. We think of ourselves as advocates for open information. We think of ourselves as advocates for education, for opening up cultural treasures, museums, for being partners for institutions and trying to achieve their works and goals. We think that this is something that really matters to all of our societies, particularly in a time in the world that often feels as though collaboration and conversation is on the decline. We think that Wikipedia offers a place for people to learn, to share, to exchange ideas, and to work through difficult conversations, through differing points of view, and present some sort of understanding of the truth that we hold globally. You know, the impact that we have had, I think, on the world is really, it's almost hard to share through one example of a story. Good. It's almost hard to share through one example or one story. That's really different. Okay. If you think about what the world was like 16 years ago, encyclopedias, if they existed in your language and if they existed in your context or were available in your country, often cost thousands of dollars. And then to be able to access them from a library was, or any forms of knowledge from a library, meant having to leave the home. It meant being close to a place where you could actually get access. It meant that some of the physical infrastructure needed to be there. Now, today, Wikipedia makes information available to hundreds of millions of people and has lowered the cost of access tremendously. So it means that people who are looking for information about medical articles in India, for example, which is a large user group for ours. We actually have a project that focuses on improving medical information for doctors and medical students in and through Wikipedia, now have access to up-to-date information that they wouldn't previously have been able to access because the cost of textbooks were too high or relevant and up-to-date information wasn't available. Now imagine this extrapolated out for almost every single sector of knowledge, and you start to see this tremendous transformative impact that projects like Wikipedia have made. And I also think this sort of inspirational impact, that it's not just about Wikipedia, it's about having a model for how collaboration and sharing can really work to make an impact and demonstrate that these projects are possible.
Mm. So more specifically, I've heard you say that, you know, participating in a project like Wikipedia can be empowering. Can you maybe earlier talking about some of the initiatives that came out of the Black Lives Matter movement, mm-hmm. feminist collectives engaging in acts similar to Wikipedia to combat online sexual harassment or cyberbullying or misogyny in general?
So Wikipedia is first and foremost an encyclopedia, and it is meant to be a neutral, reliable repository of information. But information in and of itself is somewhat... The structures of how information is created and shared reflects the structures of society. We refer to ourselves as a mirror held up to the world. Mm-hmm. So the biases that exist in terms of research, the biases that exist in terms of the media, all of these biases find their way into Wikipedia. And the reason for this is because we rely on secondary sources. So every Wikipedia article has to be cited back to a research piece or a press report. And the things that are covered in research, whether in academia or in the sciences or in the press, tend to reflect certain perspectives on the world. They tend to historically reflect male perspectives. They tend to also reflect European or American perspectives, particularly at global scale. And one thing that Wikipedians are very interested in doing increasingly is thinking about how do you write history and culture and experiences into the world through Wikipedia in a way that hasn't been done before. And so an example of this is on English Wikipedia, which is the largest Wikipedia. We have 5 million articles on that one. Only about 16% of the biographies are about women. And certainly that doesn't reflect the demographic balance of men and women in the world. So there's a huge gap in terms of the information that's available on places like Wikipedia, and that's something that people have been thinking about, how do we actively engage in this? Because if information isn't available for people to see and read and learn about, it erases the entire history and context and culture of whole groups of people. And that is something that we sort of think of as information activism. It's not necessarily about being an activist in a political sense, but it is about how do we represent things that maybe haven't been represented over time.
Well, at the same time, not a lot of your editors and volunteers are women, for example. How do you deal with something like that?
It's a great question. Wikipedia was created at a time when the early internet had sort of a different flavor and different culture, and it drew very heavily on the open source movement, which was historically very male. We feel as though that's probably one of the reasons why it evolved the way it did. Today we know that women are very much underrepresented in participation on Wikipedia, and so at the Wikimedia Foundation, we've been doing a lot of work to actively engage with our editing community and to support initiatives around first correcting the addressing the gap in information about women, but also supporting female editors who want to participate in different ways than perhaps simply sitting alone at a computer and participating. We would instead look at how do we support getting together in a room to focus on things, or projects that bring women together over time and give them the capacity and skills to really more deeply engage in the projects.
Which other marginalized communities do you engage with?
Tons. marginalization in the context of Wikipedia is a bit challenging because it actually addresses, you have to consider the marginalization of the communities across the world. What a community that might be marginalized in one country or one language is not necessarily going to be the same in another. And so we look at everything from sort of what are the socioeconomic gaps in participation on Wikipedia, what are the gender gaps in participation. You know, in India, for example, we have conversations about caste gaps on Wikipedia. So it really depends on where you are. But that's something that when we talk about our vision, which is the sum of all the world's knowledge, we firmly believe that that actually means the participation of all the world's people. And so how do you think about proactive engagement to some of these communities that haven't historically been there?
Great answer. Going back to the editing process, so the core values or editorial policies of Wikipedia are verifiability, neutrality, and always using secondary sources. So no original research.
No original research.
Makes its way into Wikipedia.
That's right.
So I was wondering if you can discuss what these values mean in practice.
Absolutely. So verifiability is thinking about you have to cite it back to something. It has to come from a reliable source. And so what does a reliable source mean? Because the reliable source for a current event is going to be very different from a reliable source about 17th century tapestries, for example. Mm-hmm. And so what we think about when we think about reliable sources is how does a source address information? Is it self-critical? Does it engage in fact-checking or peer review or some sort of editorial process? And most importantly, if it gets something wrong, does it issue a correction? So how does it engage in the production of knowledge? And that allows you to say a reliable source in one country, a reliable source in one sort of issue area, you can assess each of them individually. And we use best judgment for that. For neutral point of view or neutrality, we focus on how do you strip away some of the feelings about things. So, for example, maybe not using adjectives, but instead sticking to sort of fairly fact-based descriptions about things. It's very easy to say, for example, you know, Beirut is the most beautiful city in the Middle East. Well, I mean, I might agree, but the reality is that that's a very subjective interpretation. So what we might instead say is, how do we describe its history? How do we describe, you know, where it's situated? How do we describe the population or any of the other sorts of context, the architecture, for example? And then the issue of no original research is actually pretty simple. New knowledge is being created every single day. But if we were to update Wikipedia with that new knowledge, it'd be very hard to know what's good knowledge and what, in the sense of, you know, latest scientific discoveries versus what is a, perhaps what we would call a fringe theory, mm-hmm. something that hasn't really been vetted and accepted by experts in that field. And so we say, it's great that new knowledge is being created, but until it has gone through some form of publication or review, it doesn't really belong on Wikipedia. That will come later.
Okay. What about some of the more controversial issues, especially in the Middle East, for example, the Palestinian struggle, and there's been lots of editors. How do these usually get resolved? What is the process that's in place?
You know, we think a little bit about creating a really good article. It's like the process of creating a diamond. A lot of pressure goes into it, and at the end you have a fairly small but fairly crystalline thing. And that is one way of thinking about controversy, is can you sort out the descriptors and stick to the facts? So what do we know about dates, for example? What do we know about locations? What do we know about the names of individuals who are involved in current events? It's imperfect, certainly, but that's really the place where conversations start to happen. So within the process of creating a Wikipedia article, every article has the equivalent of a newsroom. It's called a talk page, or the equivalent in whatever language, and that's a place where editors can come together and have conversations about what sort of language they want to use in order to describe controversial or difficult things. And controversy in Wikipedia doesn't always have to be political. It can be around the type of photo you would use to illustrate an article of a city. That's fairly normal because people have different perspectives and different views. I think the thing, when you really get into controversies and people start fighting with each other, which happens, what tends to happen is another editor who's not involved will come along and they'll say, hey, we're all going to take a break, a couple hours, a day, maybe a week, maybe a month if it's really that controversial, and we're going to restore this article to the most neutral version that we can all agree upon for the time being, and we'll sit it there. And when we come back, let's see if cooler heads can prevail. And that's generally the way that we approach things, is sometimes everyone needs to take a time out and take some time to think about it and come back and say, what can we agree on? As it turns out, there was a study that was done actually by the Harvard Business School that found that, at least in English Wikipedia, if you started editing with a very partisan political perspective, if you actually stuck around, over time you became less partisan. Yeah. You started using more neutral language. You started engaging in dialogue in a different way. And so I think that's actually tremendous. If Wikipedia can be a place not just for learning, but also for conversation, that actually is a thing that's very rare on the internet today.
That's true. In a speech I was listening to earlier, you said, quote, more people want to do good than harm, unquote. And I've heard you say this several times. So how does the foundation deal with, for example, paid editing or with citations that link to what is now referred to as fake news, more commonly known as propaganda, or those who'd like us to believe that we're in a post-fact world?
Well, we don't believe that we're in a post-fact world. We believe that information is more important than ever, and that these are conversations that we should have. If we have differing points of view, how can we work through them together? So my favorite example of this is actually the article on, there are many articles about climate change and climate change science and climate change politics. And what you generally see is that that's a controversial topic for some people, not for all people, but for some. And what it tends, Wikipedia articles tend to do is they tend to focus on what does the preponderance of research show us? So if 80% of the research says this is an issue and 20% is, you know, a controversy around it, what they'll generally do is write 80% of the article reflecting what the research says, and then maybe 20% at the bottom saying here's the controversy. So that's one way that editors handle it. I should say that the Wikimedia Foundation doesn't actually address much of this at all. We take no editorial policy when it comes to Wikipedia. That's all determined by volunteer contributors. We're here to make sure the projects stay up and running, that they're accessible to the world, and that people have the resources they need to continue to participate in editing Wikipedia. But some of the ways editors handle this is that, for example, paid editing on Wikipedia, there's a number of people who focus just on that, and they sort of know what it looks like, because over time, people who engage in paid editing tend to do similar things or approach things in a way that is more promotional than other editors. And so they will pay attention to this and actually have a number of tools that exist from a software perspective to identify when that happens and then put an end to it by blocking those accounts.
I also wanted to ask you about security and privacy. And it seems like the Wikimedia Foundation cares a lot about its users and contributors and editors' privacy and security. Can you talk a little bit about it?
We do. In fact, we're one of the rare websites that really tracks very little information about you. So when you come to Wikipedia, you don't need to register an account, you don't need to give us your name, you don't need to give us your email address. You can just edit Wikipedia. And in fact, the data that we collect about users is very minimal. We don't really use cookies. We don't actually know how many people come to Wikipedia every month because we don't track individual users. We just know how many devices visit us. Okay. So that actually is a really great way to ensure that we're protecting the privacy of our users so that we don't know what you're reading. We don't want to know what you're reading. We believe that that actually has a chilling effect on learning and inquiry, and we want people to feel very safe learning about whatever it is that they need to learn about. We also get rid of the data that exists within our logs as soon as we can. We need to maintain some of it for a short period of time, but for technical reasons. But then after that, we get rid of it so that if someone comes back to us, for example, a government, in a year's time or 6 months' time, we can't really tell them anything about it because we just don't keep that data. We really believe that knowledge and learning should be a safe place for people, regardless of where they come from and regardless of what it is they're looking for.
How else does the Wikimedia Foundation protect its users in general as individuals and the content that they're creating from legal threats or from legal persecution?
Great question. So one thing that we do is that we don't respond to government takedown requests of content unless it is illegal. So that's a very, very small number of cases. So we'll receive requests, for example. We have received requests because governments don't like it because it's political content or because it's about a certain politician. And we'll evaluate that and we'll say, okay, we understand you don't like that, but that's not necessary. There's no actual basis in law for us to take this down, so we're going to keep this up. So some forms of content, yes, but we scrutinize every single request very carefully, and we publish a transparency report at the end of every year that details what it is that we've responded to, the number of requests we've received, how many we've complied with, and I can tell you, on a six-month period, we actually tend to comply with fewer than 5 requests of all of the ones that we receive, and sometimes the number is 0. So we're very anti-censorship. We believe that content should be available to everyone, no matter where they come from. That's one way that we handle this.
Which governments have you received the most takedown requests from?
I don't know that I know the answer to that, but transparency.wikimedia.org would have those answers.
Okay. So Wikipedia also has a hotline, right? And it's also run by volunteers.
Yes.
Can you tell us a little bit about the hotline, and also, like, how do you build the capacity for something like that? How do you have so many engaged volunteers?
I'm so impressed that you know about, so much about Wikipedia. Yes, we have a hotline. If you have a if there's an issue, you can go ahead and send an email to us at info@wikimedia.org, and you can actually request more information about articles, if you have questions about information. So Wikipedia has a large number of biographies, and sometimes it happens that information on a biography is wrong. Wikipedians take it very seriously, particularly for living people, because that directly impacts you. As you said, my biography was the very first search result. If I were somebody who were to search for myself and find information that was inaccurate, That could be damaging for a variety of reasons. And so one thing that our volunteers do is they'll respond to requests about information, and they'll evaluate them carefully. And very often they'll help people contact the right people in order to correct things, or sometimes in rare cases they make those corrections themselves. So we're really volunteer run in almost every way. Our helpline, our software, the content itself. In fact, my board of trustees is elected from our community. We consider ourselves a community with a foundation, not a foundation with a community.
So we're going to be talking a little bit later about Wiki Arabia and also editons. But first, we're going to watch a couple of movies about both of these. And if you want to log into your thing. So this is a Wiki Arabia tech meetup in Ramallah that took place in 2016.
Was there audio?
تعرفنا خلالها على التقنيات اللي ولا موقع ويكيبيديا العالم الشهير. ما كنت متوقع انه مؤسسه المبلغ وفيه عدد كبير من الفولنتيرز يعني المتطوعين في الاوبن سورس حول العالم. هذا شيء صادم كان لي وحبيت الفكره كثير.
Thank you. الناس تدرس أهمية ودور البرنامج ونشر في الويكيبيديا العراقيين المعلومات سواء كانت تاريخية ثقافية اجتماعية علمية نورزي العدد لأن العراق وما زال وما زلنا أن نبحث ونطور.
أسامة مثل شعار الويكيبيديا بالعراق إخراج الإنسانية.
Communities in Lebanon, in the Middle East and North Africa. And if you can briefly talk about Wiki Arabia, how we can organize editons, just share a little bit of your knowledge with us to help us grow our community here.
I should start by saying that I love these videos and I'm so delighted to see, I'm so delighted that they exist, right? I'm so happy that I was able to come to this presentation and you were able to actually have the chance to see a little bit of our broader community. But it is true, you mentioned earlier that Arabic Wikipedia is only 500,000 articles, and that's a lot of articles. I mean, any encyclopedia with 500,000 articles is a very big encyclopedia. But relative to some of the other languages that Wikipedia exists in, compared to the number of speakers of Arabic, it's very small. German Wikipedia has 2 million articles and growing. Dutch Wikipedia is one of our largest Wikipedias, and it only has 20 million speakers. So relative to the size of the population that speaks Arabic, it feels as though there's a tremendous opportunity to continue to grow the amount of knowledge that's available. And we know that there are a lot of challenges to this, and these aren't just Wikipedia challenges. The percentage of content on the Arab, on the web in general in Arabic is very low. The number of books that are published in Arabic every year is much lower than in many parts of the world, in other languages. So these are challenges beyond Wikipedia. But I'm going to be excited for a minute. And yet our Arabic community is great and very committed and very excited about organizing. So you mentioned Wiki Arabia. It's our annual conference. We held the first one in Tunisia, the second one in Jordan, and this year is going to be in Cairo. It's only been around for 3 years, but the fact that people are mobilized and organizing is a really positive development. The Wikimedians of Iraq user group, that is also new within the last 2 years. The Wikimedians of the Levant, which is a broader regional group, is new again within the last 2 years. So you're starting to see some real excitement from across the region around how do we participate in contributing to Wikipedia. What I would say is a great way to get started is to pick an issue that you care about. Find something that you think should be added, or find an article that is good but perhaps not, you know, as good as it could be, and start by editing there. That's the easiest way for an individual person to contribute, is to just go ahead and click on an article that you've seen and start making edits. But personally, I've found that it's actually often the case that you're more successful when you do this as part of a community. And so we've seen a lot of success with communities getting groups together into a room. You saw these examples of gatherings and meetups, and focusing on a particular issue. And that could be improving the quality of articles about universities in your city. It could be improving the quality of articles about famous people from recent history or the like. It could be improving the quality of articles about really any topic that you can imagine. And once you've started to do that and gotten familiar with the way that participating in Wikimedia works, then the opportunities start to be endless. We have a competition every year called Wiki Loves Monuments, which is one of the world's largest photography competitions. And the way people organize that is they identify places in their communities that aren't well documented, historic places, and they go out and they have a competition to see who can take the most beautiful images of these different places and how many can they document. It's almost like a treasure hunt for images, and that's a great way to get people who otherwise aren't thinking about free knowledge involved. We also have seen that partnerships with universities are really successful. So in both Cairo and in Palestine, that's or Egypt and Palestine, that's where some of our most successful projects have come from, a partnership with Cairo University and a partnership with Berzeit University, where we work with educators to teach people how to edit Wikipedia. And it turns out that's a great opportunity to focus on media literacy and digital literacy, get people familiar with contributing to the web. And teachers like it because there's a lot of sort of, can you trust Wikipedia? I don't know. A great answer to trusting Wikipedia is fixing Wikipedia, making it better. That's what we encourage people to do. So once you start to see the opportunities, you can engage in collaborations with educators. We work very closely with museums. I know there's the National Museum is right around the corner from here. Wouldn't it be wonderful to take some of the content that exists within their archives and history and document it so that people who will never have the opportunity to step foot in that museum can learn about the history of Lebanon? And that's the sort of thing that we've seen has been really successful and helps communities grow. So my one commitment leaving here today is that I'm planning to introduce some of these community members from the Wikimedians of the Levant to some of the folks who are here in this room so that you can connect and start to get to know each other, because there's nothing better than a great mentor to help introduce you to how to edit.
That's great. Yeah, I was going to ask you if the foundation offers any support for a collective of people.
Absolutely. In fact, that's a big part of what we do. About 25% of our work and our annual budget goes to supporting community members. And we have grants that you can apply for to do a gathering like this so that you're able to bring some snacks into the room and get people together. We also have, for our larger community groups, we provide support for them to do programmatic work so that they can engage in some of these partnerships, put materials together, make videos like the ones that you see here. So yes, the foundation is very committed from a financial but also a mentoring standpoint. We have someone who's based in Amman, Jordan, who works exclusively with our communities across the region to try to foster them so that people feel comfortable editing, they know how to get involved, and they have connections and resources that they can be a part of.
Thank you.
Yeah, my pleasure.
Right. So let's open it up for a 30-minute or so Q&A. If anybody has any questions, please go ahead.
Hi.
Hey.
I'm Mariam. I was quite impressed, actually, with what you mentioned about the non-tracking your visitors and so on. That builds trust and confidence in what you do. However, I have a question about articles which you close for editing. Mm-hmm. What's the criteria for that, and how to go around it if you assume that this is not an accurate article, but yet it's closed?
So articles can be locked for editing when, for example, there is a high likelihood that they'll be changed very rapidly, or that they'll be subject to strong viewpoints as opposed to a neutral point of view. The Wikimedia Foundation doesn't make a decision what articles to lock. That's actually made by members of the community who have what we call administrative rights, which means that they have been voted by their peers to have those rights based on their history of contributions over time. However, when you see an article that's locked, it usually means it's locked to people who are newer editors. And over time, if you have a record of contributing within the community, you can actually edit that article as long as you're logged in and you have a certain number of edits. So one way of thinking about how you could participate in an article is to start learning how to edit Wikipedia in other places so that you get the hang of it, you learn some of the rules and policies, the way that people work. You can actually introduce yourself to other editors and get to understand them and make personal connections. And then that usually is a sort of a pathway to participating in some of these articles that have been closed. Now, for more information for folks who aren't familiar with this, articles tend to be locked when very rarely permanently. The goal is only to lock them for the shortest period of time possible. A great example of this is anytime an election happens, almost all of the politicians' pages end up locked because people come in and they try to change them really quickly. So that tends to happen, but then as soon as Wikipedia editors can, they try to open them up again because we rarely want to have something that's closed for editing indefinitely. Yeah.
Nabil Bukhalid. I feel that there is a certain consensus on the articles that are on Wikipedia, where you reach to what is everybody is agreeing on rather than the actual facts. Mm-hmm. How true is that?
I suppose it depends on the articles. If you were to say that an example that I like to use is the example of whether the Earth revolves around the sun or whether the sun revolves around the Earth. You know, a couple hundred years ago, we would have written a Wikipedia article to say that the sun revolves around the Earth. Today, we know more information about the way that the universe works, and so we write the articles to say that, you know, the Earth revolves around the sun. So it is true that Wikipedia articles tend to be based on the best known available information, but I think what you're probably referring to is, you know, strong points of view that are introduced into the editing process. This is actually one of the reasons that we would call for a greater diversity of participants and editors. The more diversity that we have in terms of people's experiences, people's backgrounds, the information that they know and understand, the better the conversations can be about what the actual substance of an article can be. And that's really where that sort of dialogue process for Wikipedia becomes very valuable. We know that if we have a very small editing community, for example, in a small language, then it actually becomes very easy for articles to have more bias than they should have. So for us, when we see this, we say, gosh, that's a problem. We actually, for us, that means let's try to encourage more people to participate so we can have these conversations and try to get a full range of perspectives and information into them.
Can I have another question? I mean, I'm concerned that the article that are in one language are not translated to the other language as is. Where, I mean, somebody will come and edit from the Arabic side, will write something different that is not also translated to English. And I'm going to validate my statement. I mean, I grew up in a French school where I learned about the Crusades from French books. Mm-hmm. And until I reached 19, a book fell in my hand, The Crusade, as seen from the Arab side. Mm-hmm. And it is completely different.
Very different perspectives.
From the other perspective. Which one is true?
It's a good question.
Now I can tell because academician used to take the Crusade as seen from the Arabic perspective seems to be more close to reality than the other one. So, I mean, this is a concern. That book, I mean, a very small number of academicians will see. Mm-hmm. While the majority will see the others, mm-hmm. which are biased. So how do you address this?
So this would be where we would argue that having more people participating in knowledge creation is valuable. This is where we would say Wikipedia is biased. It's biased towards certain perspectives. It's biased to the history of certain parts of the world. We know, for example, when we talk to our Wikipedians in places in sub-Saharan Africa, that most articles are written, 75% of contributions to articles about anything about Africa are from outside of Africa. Does that represent what the African experience is? No, not really. And very often, the articles are cited to research papers that have been written by Western academics. Now, that's helpful to have that information, but it doesn't necessarily represent a full range of perspectives. And so for us, we know that this is a bias, we acknowledge it, and it's one of the things that, from the foundation, we actually try to support through grants and through other modes of support to get more participation for more people so that the fuller representation of history and other information can be included in Wikipedia. But we very much acknowledge it. And in fact, we have this expression in Wikipedia, you know, if you see something, you should fix it. Like, if you see a problem, you should fix it. And so when you ask this question, it's a great thing to highlight it. And then my response would be, fantastic, now let's get people participating and editing and adding these additional perspectives. And sometimes when people can't agree on one perspective in an article, what you might end up having, for example, the history of the Crusades or the history of the Ottoman Empire, you might have two articles, one which says the history of the perspective on the Crusades from Arabic historians, and then you might have one that's sort of, you know, Western historians on the history of the Crusades. And that's completely fine, because what you're actually documenting at that point is not the history of the Crusades, but the academic research that is representative of two very different experiences of that. And that's great. There's room on Wikipedia for many, many more articles. We don't have a bookshelf that we're trying to fit it in.
The question is, you have an Arabic.
The language divide, yes. So this is Wikipedia was never intended to have one version of information. When you write an article, for example, if I were to write an article about where I'm from in the United States, the way I would write it would assume a certain familiarity with the reader. I would assume a familiarity because the reader is an English speaker with certain things. If I were to read an article about where I'm from in the United States in Arabic, I would expect more information would be necessary to contextualize it. So one-to-one translations are not very helpful. If I'm reading an article about the history of film in the Arab world, I'm going to need more information as a non-native Arabic speaker who didn't grow up in this part of the world to understand really what, you know, who individuals are, who the stars were, these sort of things. So we don't really want Wikipedia to be a translation one-to-one, but we do, I agree, want more information transferred. And one project that we're working on is a way of mapping all the different articles that exist, because right now there are articles that exist in English Wikipedia that don't exist in Swahili Wikipedia, that don't exist in Arabic Wikipedia, that don't exist in Chinese Wikipedia, but imagine how much more information we would have about the world if we knew how all of these different Wikipedias were created. I would be able to learn so much more about places that are completely off the map for English Wikipedia. There's an estimate that suggests that there are about 105 million notable things in the world. Somebody that edits Wikipedia has made this estimate, and it's just a rough estimate. English Wikipedia, which is the largest, has only 5 million articles. So there's clearly a lot of work that we have to do in order to really have a perspective on what knowledge actually is. There's a lot that's still missing.
Hi. Around like 5 or 6 years ago, Wikimedia Foundation have started an academic program that started, I think, in the new British Columbia University in Canada and some other American university, where to increase the credibility of Wikipedia within the academic society, where students or part of like English literature or whatever class, the students started to writing articles or new articles or new content on Wikipedia in their own language. Mm-hmm. So I tried to contact Wikimedia back then, like 2011, and asked them to do the same in my university, but they said no, we prefer to have it in Arabic. So, because we're in Lebanon and so on. So is that program still active? How can you?
Yes, so we have that particular program, which was called the policy program, is no longer active in the US, but we do have a global education program, and that global education program now exists in, I think, 80 different countries. As I mentioned, for example, the Cairo University and Beirut University, but many other places around the world where we have partnerships with educational institutions. And if, you know, I'm not sure if you're still at university, but, you know, if there's an interest in starting a program like this up, we actually have people who are more than excited to participate and help coach or mentor a program like this as it gets started, including what we found is that the learning can often be best from the professors who are currently doing this to new professors to help explain how it works and get them involved. So if you are interested and have someone to introduce me to, I am interested and ready to be introduced.
So, two questions. The first is a follow-up to something that you mentioned in the initial discussion, which is that you often don't comply with host government requests to take down content, only in cases where it's illegal. So I was curious, that is illegal according to whose laws? Because
right.
There are lots of instances,
that's a great
like
question.
Let's say in the Middle East, where, you know, it's illegal to insult the president and maybe something that is on your Wikipedia.
So,
but, you know, so that, yeah, if you want to answer that, and then I'll get, yeah.
Sure, so we're hosted in the United States, which means that we comply with US jurisdiction.
Okay.
So that's the jurisdiction that we comply with.
Okay.
And as you probably may know, the U.S. has some fairly extensive what we call safe harbor protections that allow for content to exist in places in ways that is not the case in other places, including not just the Middle East, but in Europe and many other places around the world have far more restrictive limitations on what content can exist. So that tends to be the standard by which we apply in terms of the evaluation of content. It's far more likely that if we get a request for some sort of content change or alteration, that we would actually let the community know that we'd received this request, and the community would make a decision as to how to handle it. We really do not take down content.
do you ever find that host governments block Wikipedia in particular? They do. Does that happen frequently? I mean, you hear about it with like Twitter and Facebook and stuff, but that's a common occurrence for you guys.
We've been blocked in different places at different times in the past. I believe that Chinese Wikipedia is currently blocked in China, but it tends to be fairly rare that this is the case. And about 2 years ago, we transferred over to a more secure form of encryption called HSTS. And when we did so, now if you want to block Wikipedia, you have to block all of Wikipedia rather than a single page. And as it turns out, most places aren't comfortable blocking a site that so many millions of people rely on every day.
Interesting. Last question, I promise. I'm interested to what extent you guys have studied the correlation between Wikipedia use and democratic reform and development, particularly in the MENA region. If you find that there is a correlation between those two things, and if you think that causality might go both ways, not just that, you know, more democratic countries, you know, those citizens tend to read Wikipedia more, but actually that by promoting the use, and this is probably something that you'd like to think, whether or not it's true or not, I'd like to get your opinion, but that, you know, the more that you use Wikipedia in a society, the more naturally informed and then subsequently democratic it becomes. Have you guys looked at that connection at all?
I have not looked at that connection. I don't believe that our research team has looked at that connection, but I like to say that, you know, Wikipedia is the project that launched a million PhD dissertations because all of our research and all of our data is public. So if you want to look into that as a researcher, by all means, like, ahlan wa sahlan, we would love to understand.
Yeah, I'm totally not a researcher. I'm not doing that.
You know, I do think it's an interesting question about the availability of open information and open knowledge in terms of what does that mean for open societies and informed societies. We do believe that the more information that people have available to them, the better off everyone is. And that is the case in terms of, you know, innovations in engineering and improvements in health, you know, outcomes, let alone, you know, more democratic and open and tolerant societies. So we tend to believe that knowledge is good, and, you know, that's why we don't censor content, for example. The more information you have, we tend to believe that our users are smart, and the information that we make available to them, they know they can make judgments about whether to trust it, whether to use it, whether to check the citations. But as to the correlation between Wikipedia and democracy, I will leave that to the researchers and check the citations. Sure.
Thank you. In terms of editing Wikipedia Arabic, trying to work with educators and students to create content, I realized that one of the main problems, there are many, but one of them is that references and citations are often in English. Mm-hmm. So what we end up doing is create Arabic pages on Wikipedia, but Lincoln, which are referenced in Western depictions of everything we're trying to see. And it's not because there are no references in Arabic, it's because they're not accessible. Mm-hmm. Because oftentimes those references are published in books, mm-hmm, or in magazines. We see them in, you know, Ma'ar al-Kitab in Beirut, but mm-hmm, they're not accessible online. Mm-hmm. So do you think it's a problem? Is this something you're trying to think around,
yes,
within Wikipedia Arabic?
Definitely.
And is digitization of more references in Arabic one of the plans you guys are looking into?
Yes, yes, and yes. We would love to see all of those things. We would love to see more digitization of resources. That would be incredible, and not just for us. That's good for the entire knowledge ecosystem, of course. I can tell you, we actually did launch a project, a program that was our, we have a project called the Wikipedia Library, which gives Wikipedia editors access to scholarly journals and information for free. So it gives free logins, and then you can use them to edit Wikipedia and add additional information. And the whole idea is to address the barrier of paywalls, which exists all over the world, not just in this part of the world or just in Arabic. When we first launched the Wikipedia Library, one thing that we focused on was actually a lending program in Arabic for our Arabic editors to get access to books that they didn't otherwise have. And it turns out it was almost impossible from a logistic perspective to actually get people what they needed on the timeframes that they needed them, and dealing with customs and shipping and all of these other things. So if you would like to talk more about ways that we might address this, I think we are all ears. Because yes, we know that it's a challenge, and our efforts so far have not proven successful. But one thing we've learned is that just means we need to try a different way.
Yeah, that's an annoying question. Do you accept citations from an organization that chairs your prefect, which is WikiLeaks?
I don't know, because it would be different on every Wikimedia project, because the editors determine the editorial policy, so I wouldn't want to make a blanket statement about one language version versus another. I want to say I believe that there have been citations from there, but then again, it's original source material, not secondary source material, so it's more likely that you would find citations to journalistic articles covering what would be in leaked documents than you would find citations to leaked documents themselves.
Hi, thanks for being here. We're all really excited to have you. When you were talking about the biographies, a little light bulb went off in my head, and I started thinking, and so I want to make sure I heard what you said, which is that the editors are very particular about the biographies.
Yes.
And the reason for that, I mean, they don't want to get personal information wrong about people, et cetera. And in my mind, living here as I do, I start thinking about defamation mm-hmm. and these sorts of things. And then I start thinking about all the different things that you're saying about how this community has started and how editors have wars and then there's cooling off periods and that biographies get special care and that there's a hotline for things. And I start thinking to myself that Wikipedia may in some strange way have started solving problems around free expression online in a community way. And I'm wondering, has anyone documented, or same question as this gentleman here, but like, what do you see that we can learn from the fact that this has already been going on for what, like almost
16 years?
16 years. And we're here saying, oh, it's all new, all this defamation and you know, fake news and all this stuff. But yet Wikipedia has been dealing with this since from the very beginning. So it's only because maybe it doesn't have the commercial profile or the, I mean, you know, not that you don't have a huge profile, obviously you do, you're at the top
different.
Of all the search results, but like, you're not covered in the same way.
No.
What can the media learn from the way Wikimedia operates? Like, it's just fascinating that it just kind of went off in my head. This has already been happening for so long, so
yeah,
ruminate.
Well, we've made our mistakes. I think that that's the most important thing to highlight. But one thing about Wikipedia that I really appreciate is that, as I was saying earlier, when we make those mistakes, the usual response of a Wikimedian when they found out a mistake exists is to ask where it is so they can fix it. Because the goal is always to have better and better information. The reason this biography's care came about is because there was a hoax on a article about a very famous journalist in the United States, somebody who had covered the civil rights movement, who was sort of this very well-respected gentleman. His name was John Siegenthaler. And there was a hoax introduced into his article that said he was complicit in the assassination of Robert Kennedy, the former Attorney General of the United States. Well, that wasn't true. In fact, they were close personal friends. But it was very damaging to him as a person, because now that information existed. It had existed on Wikipedia, which is one of the world's biggest and most popular websites. And so that is now part of his he's passed away since, but it's part of his legacy that he was the subject of a hoax. When that happened, Wikipedians went, whoa, wait a minute, we need to get way better at thinking about what information goes in and out and how it's cited for biographies. And so that's part of the process, is being transparent, being accountable, owning up to mistakes and being honest with them. I'd love to see that in more parts of the internet, to be sure. I do think that there's a lot that the internet, or even we in conversation with in this room, can learn from the way that this works. It's by trial and error. It's by transparency in the process, so that flaws in the design of information and flaws in the design of collaboration can be spotted and addressed quickly. I like to say we've been dealing with fact and fiction for 16 years now, but it's not just Wikipedia that's been solving this. We've learned how to solve it from people who've come before. Peer research, editorial review, fact checking. These are practices that have been in place since, you know, I love the example of the use of citations in academic research came from the trial of Galileo. These are not new practices. They're just practices that we need to continue to adapt and adopt for this time that we're in. But as for research that's been done, I think it would be a great issue area for research. And it's very imperfect, but researching so that we understand where it's imperfect, I hope will only spur further improvement.
I mean, and I think, sorry, I'm not gonna, I think there's also something to be said that the radical openness with which Wikipedia works, and yet still you've been able to work your way through, and the diversity of the community, okay, it's not as diverse as we'd like, but more diverse than any other editing community that we can all think of.
Mm-hmm.
But I think the key is that there's a common goal.
Yes, a common goal, radical openness, transparency, and accountability. I think these are critical to getting anything done. And that that common goal is more knowledge for the world, which means that you can participate because you really like editing about battleships, and that's fun, and you know are a historian of military history, or you can participate because you really fundamentally believe that increasing access to information is critical to improving equity globally. And it allows for people who just want to edit about Pokemon and people who want to change the world. Space for both.
Does anybody other questions?
Yes, maybe this question also relates to what you've already said, also concerning biographies. How do you judge and estimate what is relevant? Mm. Like if you have an entry, let's say, and do you leave it up to the community or to some senior contributors to say this is relevant and this is not? Especially like concerning to biographies where like everybody could be on Wikipedia or not.
So that gets back to the standard of notability, which I realize we didn't actually talk about yet. So for something to have an article on Wikipedia, it needs to be determined to be notable. And what notability means is not that it's famous. And I often use the example of there are scientists who I've never heard of that are on Wikipedia, and it doesn't matter that they're not famous, it matters that they had contributed something meaningful to their field. Conversely, there are people that we know their names because they were the subject of some news event, but they're not actually notable because they didn't really contribute anything. They just happened to be in the limelight for 15 minutes. Those people probably don't deserve an article on Wikipedia. Maybe the situation they found themselves in deserves an article, but not the individual. So notability really relies on a couple of different things, but the easiest one to determine is, has a subject of an article, whether it's a person or otherwise, been written about in multiple sources that are relevant to its field? So it doesn't mean that the BBC has written about it, but it might mean an academic journal or a publisher that's focused on artists has written about this, or even in some cases, informal citizen media that covers a certain topic or area. And that standard of notability requires one or two secondary sources to have covered a topic in order for it to exist on Wikipedia. And that's sort of how you determine the difference between things that are famous, but perhaps not actually important, and things that are important, but not necessarily well known. And every community has a different approach. You know, English Wikipedia is more inclusive. I can say, for example, German Wikipedia tends to be more strict in what they include. They all have sort of different characters and flavors.
My question is, I understand the importance of such efforts, but also how do you decide how the translation is made?
Mm-hmm.
So is it like translation, localization, who do you engage with this process? And how do you do some kind of a version control when it comes to like, okay, is this article, does it have an Orientalist perspective or Orientalist bent? And so how do you go about that?
So at the foundation, we don't set any of those policies because those are all set by community, but I can give you some of what I understand, the way the community handles this. One thing that we have done is we've built a content translation interface so that If you're an editor, you can translate between any two languages. You can translate between Bahasa and Portuguese if you want. And we think that's really important because it's not about English having the most information or French or the like. It's about sharing across languages. We have also integrated 92 different machine translation languages. So if you're somebody who, like me, I understand some German, I'm not fluent at it, but I can machine translate and then I can fix things in order to make sure that the article is at least roughly good. Those are different ways that you can approach it, or you can just translate raw. If you're somebody who enjoys translation, you can do that independently. To your questions about things such as how do you address tone, for example, Orientalism creeping into an article about the Crusades, that's really up to the discretion of the individual editor, and that's why we don't try to just bulk translate from one encyclopedia to another, because some content that is appropriate in certain contexts, and I'm not saying Orientalism is appropriate, just some content that's appropriate in certain contexts is not as valuable to another community. And so instead, that's why we encourage, here are the tools that you can use, but it's really at the discretion of the editing community itself. We want to facilitate it, we want to encourage it. Today, about 3,000 articles a month are translated between, 3,000 articles a week are translated between Wikipedias, so it's an active thing that community members around the globe are involved in. But we're really about giving people the tools to do it rather than saying how they should and shouldn't. And that's something we think is actually really at the core of how Wikipedia works around the world. Communities, to Jess's point earlier, have approached things such as content standards differently depending on where they're based. They've approached what they want to write about differently depending on where they're based, what languages they speak. It's what makes different Wikipedias feel different. So a language that's spoken in just one part of the world will have a different feel than a language that's spoken broadly across a larger region or place. And that's okay from our perspective.
I think that wraps up our Q&A. Thank you for a very insightful talk.
Thank you.
And thank you for great questions. If you're leaving inspired by our conversation here and you would like to be involved in the open knowledge communities that we're trying to build, please leave your contact information with me, Muhammad, or Jessica. And I hope you're all signed up to our newsletter so you can find out about our next event. Thank you.
Thank you so much.